What if Bill Gates had started Microsoft in India? What if Silicon Valley was a region in China? The standard of living that we all enjoy today, everyone in this room, is a direct result of the United States of America being a global leader in engineering, in science and technology, the very fuel of the global economy. Yet, there is increasing concern that the U.S. is losing its technical edge. Clearly, China, India, they got a lot more people than us. They can put out an awful lot more engineers. And in fact, this article here was about how we need to reach students more at the critical age, prepare students for success in careers in science and engineering. Critically important work for the future of this country. Yet, if we don't start questioning our equation in higher education, we're going to be sorely disappointed with the results. Our equation for what it takes to become an engineer is a year and a half of traditional math and science prerequisites before students can make any real progress towards our own degrees. You want to take a class in statics, in dynamics, electric circuits? Great. Go over to the College of Science and Math and do well in Calculus 1, and then Calculus 2, and then Calculus 3, and then differential equations. Meanwhile, the traditional calculus sequence is the primary cause of attrition in engineering programs all over the country. Success rates in calculus are some 60%, and that's not even the primary issue. I mean, what if the success rate was 70%? Boy, that'd be pretty good. Well, take 0.7 to the fourth power and see how many people are coming back. So the nation's leaders, the National Academy of Science and Engineering, the President's Council on Jobs and Competitiveness, saying, look, we got to have 10,000 more engineers just for short-term economic viability. Nationwide, only about 1 out of 3 students that aspires to be an engineer ever earns a degree. Students that have already been prepared and trained and recruited and motivated to come to us, yet 1 out of 3 actually earns a degree. We can far exceed 10,000 engineers a year if we start addressing our own curricular barriers and graduating more of the students that we already have. So at Wright State University, about a decade ago, we started to question our equation. This equation of what it takes to become an engineer. A year and a half of prerequisite math over here. See who comes out the other end. You wonder why our 6-year graduation rates were 30%. And we said, look, we're not going to do this anymore. Calculus is not going to be a bottleneck. It's not going to be a litmus test for who can become an engineer. And so we said, well, we still have to teach rigorous engineering. We need concepts of calculus in circuits class, right? In statics and dynamics, what are we going to do? And we said, well, what if we taught math in context? Now, what if we showed students why all the math actually matters for the degrees that they are seeking? What if we did that in the first year as the cornerstone of the entire curriculum? What if we create EGR 101, introductory math for engineering applications, and use that as the bottleneck for who could be an engineer, right? And so the calculus for us, it's all still required, but we've turned it into general education for engineers, right? And that's not meant to be a negative connotation. The same way we want 38 semester hours of arts and humanities and musics and the things we need in the engineer of 2020, we need a whole bunch of math. Right? We need a bunch of math to develop analytical thinking, problem-solving skills, all the rest of it. But we don't need to jam it down the throat of our incoming students and weed out 2/3 of the population before they make progress towards degree. So we questioned our equation. We changed our degree programs across the bat. We put in EGR 101, and here was the result. What's shown here red and blue bars. It's the entire incoming class in the College of Engineering and Computer Science at Wright State from the year 2000 through the year 2006. We instituted EGR 101 in 2004. The blue bars are the graduation rates sorted by incoming ACT math level for all the students that did not take EGR 101. And the red bars are students entering after 2004 that were in majors that required now EGR 101 as the cornerstone of the curriculum. So what we have essentially is a before and half picture, before and after picture of what's possible. And so what you see is the national problem, right? The blue bars showing that ACT, right, the measure, you know, what higher education believes, the measure of your ability to be successful, right? The median kid in the country is an ACT math of 24. That's a student two classes behind calculus. Look at our blue bar. Graduation rate, there's 250 people in that blue bar. One out of five got a degree. 200 engineers gone because of the traditional structure of the curriculum. Flash forward now to EGR 101, take a look at the red bars. We have completely wiped out the impact of math preparation. Where are you? What's your ACT math score on whether or not you can be an engineer? We can graduate an ACT 20 student at the same rate as an ACT 28. Yet engineering programs all over the country are effectively, whether it's their mission or not, they're effectively only serving the top 10, 15% of the population. Right, the ACT 30 and higher, these are the kids that it doesn't matter how inaccessible your curriculum is, they can make it anyway. Okay, but I would argue that the future of US global competitiveness is the fat part in the middle. It is an ACT 20 all the way to 30. That's where the population is. This is where the future of America's economic leadership lies. So what's the face of the future of our global competitiveness? Well, Josh Deaton is one of those faces. Josh Deaton right now is a PhD candidate, okay, in engineering, and he's a future entrepreneur. He's got entrepreneurial stuff going on right now that I'm quite certain his PhD advisor has absolutely no idea he's doing. He graduated summa cum laude, one of the best students in his entire class, which, mind you, was a really strong group of kids, one of the best ones coming out. Yet his preparation coming in wasn't the same as some of these other kids. He went to a rural school district, not a lot of opportunities. They didn't even have calculus at his high school. The poor guy entered engineering two classes behind calculus one. If he would have seen the chart I showed you, okay, he would have realized that his odds of being successful were about 1 in 5. This is also why he later told me that he was just about to switch his major when he took EGR 101, okay? And he's now one of the finest graduate students in the history of Wright State University. The face of global competitiveness, okay, is Lindsey Parrott. Lindsey Parrott's an engineer right now, Booz Allen Hamilton. She's a master's student in electrical engineering. Bachelor's degree in electrical engineering 2012. And you say, well, yeah, I mean, she came from a good school district, Centerville High School. This is affluent, excellent preparation of students. Only problem is, Lindsey wasn't a very good student. Okay, Lindsey graduated in the bottom half of her class. She had mediocre ACT scores. She showed up at Wright State three math classes behind Calculus 1. Her odds of success in a traditional curriculum were maybe 1 in 10. Lindsey walked into my own first year classroom. She looked like the picture of American pop culture. Hey, the girl walked in with tie-dye shirts, Vans, tons of makeup on, piercings different places, and I'm thinking, this is the future of tomorrow's engineer, okay? And I remember, it's one of the best stories ever, okay? I remember, you know, about 2 years later, Lindsey being successful in our program, you know, more than anything else, she wants to be a rocket scientist, okay? And so she's applying for, you know, where do you go and work for an internship? You want to be a rocket scientist? NASA, right? So she says, Dr. K, I need a reference letter. You know, and I'm looking at her background and all the rest of that, and I'm thinking, man, this is not usually what NASA hires, okay? And so I'm writing a letter, and I said, look, you know, I'm reminded, I literally, this is in a letter, I'm reminded of the line from Risky Business. Okay, now if you've seen that movie, right? So it's when the recruiters actually come to the house, and after the gigantic, you know, weekend-long party, he says to Tom Cruise, he says, look, Princeton really needs a guy like you. And I said, and I believe with every fiber of my being, that NASA needs a girl like Lindsey Parrott. She didn't get the job, okay? But you can see her success right now, and I won't be surprised if I hear from Lindsey in a few years and she is a rocket scientist. And then finally, the face of US global competitiveness is Derek Watley. Derek Watley is currently a mechanical engineering student at Wright State. And you know, his background transferred in from a community college in 2010 after being academically dismissed from the University of Cincinnati in 2007. Born and raised in Cincinnati, disadvantaged neighborhood, went to Cincinnati Public Schools. Now he graduated from one of the premier Cincinnati Public Schools. The place he was at before that, he told me, I think 3 days ago, they would deal drugs and guns in the bathroom. First person in his family, 9 brothers and sisters, no one's ever gone to college before. This guy wants to try engineering. So he shows up at Wright State after this track record that he has had, right, of really successive kind of academic failure, okay, and he showed up 3 math classes behind calculus. Hey, but the thing about Derek is Derek really wants to be an engineer, right? So he sits in the front row of my EGR 101 class, and I can't get through an example problem, I can't get a schematic on the board without Derek's hand up and Derek saying, Dr. K, you've got to explain to me what's actually happening inside the resistor. So a couple times I had to say, well, this is engineering math class, Derek, but yeah, right, this is why we do math in context, right? Can we use the physics to help explain the math? And Derek didn't want math that didn't have physics that went with it. And so that was it, right? So he's a dedicated student, never missing a lecture, okay, but still can't quite take the inner city out of the kid. It's his entire life. It's where he still lives. Right? And so the homework is spotty, it's not always turned in, the grades are kind of mediocre. First midterm exam, he turns in a grade, it's like a 71 or something. And he comes to my office, he's like, Dr. K, yeah, I'm really sorry about that first exam performance. He's like, yeah, don't worry, I got this. I didn't have my act together, I'm really gonna work, I'm gonna do good next exam. I said, all right, Derek, go do what you need to do. So 3-4 weeks later, we have the second midterm. We do these in block. Right, 8 to 10 p.m. at night, everybody at once. I get this late night email, it's like 11:30 p.m. Hey, and you know, it's this long, it's like a novel. And Derek's explaining to me how, you know, he has been preparing for this exam nonstop for a week. How he slept in the lab on Sunday night. So he'd be there for the TA Monday morning. Keep in mind the exam is Wednesday night. Okay? This kind of preparation and dedication, yet the email goes on to say, and I failed. I was not successful. And I said, you know, and it was pleading. It was, Dr. K, can I do extra credit? Can I come in and do some special project? You know, I've got to be able to post a good score. I said, Derek, this is not the way the real world works. Right? You're going to fail. You got to pick yourself up, get off the ground, and look what's next. What's next is the final exam. In my 14 years as an educator, with students like Josh Deaton, and we have other students, I got a guy, James Dahlman, valedictorian of Fairmont High, doing a PhD, you know, MD at MIT and Harvard. I have seen achievement that will blow your mind, but I've never seen an achievement like that achieved by Derek Watley. 140-some students took my final exam. There were 3 perfect scores. 2 scores by university honors students with AP credit for calculus. A 3rd perfect score, Derek Watley. Okay. And so naturally, I thought this was a mistake. All right, and so I dug through the pile. I had the pile of exams, and I rummaged through the pile, and I found his exam, and it looked like an exam that was done by a middle schooler. It was a mess. It was eraser marks everywhere, stuff scratched out, but 5 pages of detailed handwritten calculation, my own solutions. Derek Watley, every single answer, every box, every graph, labeled units, everything correct. Would not be possible if we did not question our equation. And so I ask you, what's your equation? Whatever your walk of life, what are the traditional ways that you do things that limit not only your achievement, but the achievement of those around you? Maybe it's time to question it. Thank you.